When they stop the music, it's time to start. Good morning. Welcome. Happy Father's Day to all of you for whom that applies. I will tell you this, my wife, every Mother's Day greeting before I leave the house, she says that she loves me. And she says, don't say anything stupid on Mother's Day. In 40 years of marriage, she's never said that about Father's Day. You can draw your own conclusions about that. There are several announcements I want to share with you this morning. By the way, another thing about Father's Day, people ask me, how's your Father's Day? And I say, it's good. So far, no one's asked me for any money. So it's a good day so far. Some announcements. I have so many here. First, tomorrow night, we're feeding rafting guides. Last Monday night, we fed 128. And so our numbers are increasing, which is wonderful and frightening, because tomorrow night I'm cooking. And so we're going to have breakfast casserole. So it's kind of a biscuits, gravy, sausage, egg casserole. And they typically really like that. But we don't want salad, but we would like to have fruit. And so if you can help us by bringing fruit, Lana's going to get a great big bowl and just put a bunch of fruit and kind of stir it all up. Not a fruit salad, but kind of like that. So if you could drop off some fruit around 3 o'clock, that would be wonderful. We'd appreciate that. I'm not serving breakfast in the morning. I'm serving breakfast at night. Thank you. Yes. So it'll be at 7 o'clock. Good distinction there. But anyway, that's happening tomorrow. So I need all the fruit I can get and all the homemade desserts that you can bring around 3 o'clock. If you could bring that, that would be greatly appreciated. And then if you want to come help us greet and serve and clean up and all of that, we would love for you to be a part of that. So that's tomorrow. Then Wednesday night, this week, I have 5 ministry leaders that are going to be coming to our home out at Lost Creek Ranch, and we're doing a soul care retreat there, Sacred Journey Soul Care Retreat. And one of the things that we want to do is invite you to be a part of our Wednesday night meal. So I'm cooking taco salad, and I want to invite you to come and be a part of that, along with these ministry leaders. I want you to see faces. I've asked you to pray for them in the past. And I want you to see a face this time. So we're going to have them here. And all you have to do is come. And we have a sign-up sheet. It's out in the entryway. And hello, Bob.
I'll bring you salsa.
Okay, you bring salsa. That's awesome. So we have a sign-up sheet because I'd kind of like to have a head count of how many to expect for you so we can make enough taco salad for everyone. But I would love for you to come and interact with these ministry leaders that come from different parts of the country. One from California, some from the Northwest, and some from here in Colorado. So we'd love for you to come and be a part of that. And all you have to do is just visit, enjoy the taco salad and the fellowship, and visit. So if you would come, the meal is at 6 o'clock this Wednesday. But please sign up. I think I'm going to ask my wife to stand back there with a sign-up sheet. Could you do that? Okay. So that you have to walk past her to get out of here without that. All right. Then next Sunday... next Saturday, actually, Blue Valley Church from Kansas City will be here. And the week following that, they will be serving the rafting guides every night. But next Sunday night, they're going to do a cookout for us and for everyone that lives in the farm. So this housing addition over here, we've invited them to come and be a part of this free cookout. They're going to cook hot dogs and hamburgers and that kind of thing. And the idea is to let the farm know that we're here, and we'd love them to be a part of our community and let them know we love them and that we want to care for them. So we've invited them, and we would like to have our congregation be here as well as the folks from Blue Valley. It's not going to be as helpful to have 38 Blue Valley folks here and interacting with folks and then leave and they never see them again. So we need you to be here on Sunday night. Next Sunday night for that. So Blue Valley will be here next Sunday morning, and there'll be another 38 or 40 folks here when they come, and then we'll have that cookout next Sunday evening. All right. I'm looking at the note that my wife gave me, make sure. So Sunday school, one more thing about Sunday school. We have a men's class, and it meets back here, men's Sunday school class, if you're interested in being a part of that. We have a ladies' class. We actually have two ladies' classes. We have one that meets in the library, and Lana and Joanne, where are you, Joanne? You all kind of share that responsibility, don't you, in teaching that? Some of you do? That's right. Okay, so you guys meet in the library. Then we have a Helen's class. Helen, raise your hand and wave at us. She's the beautiful lady back here in the yellow, and she meets as far away from us as we can get her, which is out in the far. You meet in the shed back there, don't you? Is that where your Sunday school class is? No, the last room on the left down there, and she'd been teaching Bible study here for a long time, haven't you? And so there's a women's Sunday school class, and we have Tethered in Faith, which my dad and Pat and others teach, and it meets back here, which is a mixed group for anyone who wants to come. And then next Sunday, Lynette and I are starting a new couples class, and it will be meeting back here too. So if you're not currently in Sunday school, if you're in Sunday school, stay there. But if you're not attending Sunday school, we would love for you to come to our class, adult couples class at 9:30. Did that do everything? Okay. Thank you to Dan Ehlers for preaching for me last Sunday. I was in Oklahoma, and I realized why I live in Colorado when I went to Oklahoma. When we were coming back, you guys know how hot it was down there? Do you know? It doesn't matter, does it? It mattered to me a great deal because it melted my car on the way out. It was 105 as we drove from Oklahoma into Texas, and we had, you know, there's these runners, these rubber on top of your car so that when you put luggage up there, it doesn't scratch your car. It started melting it, and it started curling backwards as we came to Colorado. So, and duct tape wouldn't even hold it down. I'm just saying, yeah, we really looked high class with that. So, are you glad you're here today? Happy Father's Day. I'm preaching on the murder of Abel and Cain today, so this is a wonderful Father's Day sermon. Happy Hallmark kind of thing, but it's kind of where I found myself in Genesis, so that's what we're talking about today. Let's prepare our hearts for worship. Lord, thank you for your grace and your mercy. Thank you for the love that you have for us. Thank you for the way that you protect us and the way that you pursue us. We light this candle to remind us that you are the light of the world and that without your life, we cannot see anything of eternal value. And we ask you now, Lord, to be present with us. In your name we pray. Amen. Stand with me, please, as we continue to prepare our hearts for worship by confessing our sins to the Lord. God's love has been poured out in our hearts through the gift of the Holy Spirit. The proof of God's amazing love is this: while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Because we have faith in him, we dare approach God in confidence. Triune God, we praise you as the God of love and life. Though Jesus prayed that we would be one, we confess that we fail to live in unity with each other and with you. We break our communion through hostile words and unkind actions. We long for your Spirit to heal us and to connect us. We long for you to help us experience communion with you and with each other as we gather around your word. Even now, dependent on your grace, we commit ourselves to live more fully in the unity you desire. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old is gone and a new life has begun. Believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen.
Let's remain standing, because now is the time to worship.
Here we go.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Choose to surrender our lives. Willingly every knee will bow. With all our heart, my soul, mind, and strength, we gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are, to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come, come, just as you are. Seated.
Let's pray together. There's something on your heart that you'd like to bring before the Lord, would you just vocalize that now?
Lord, I want to lift up Dan's sister, Joan. I ask that you be with her as she has treatment for some sort of issue. Don't know whether it's heart related or what, but just ask that you would help her.
And Lord, we pray for Dan Ehlers, who is preaching this morning in Leadville, and we pray, Lord, that you would speak through him to that congregation. We pray for the other pastors in Chaffee County, especially those here in Buena Vista, Pastor Charlie, Pastor Zach, Pastor Brett, Pastor Ken, and many, many others, Lord, that are preaching the gospel. I pray, Lord, that you would anoint their words, that someone would come to faith in you today. We pray for in our country, Lord, for the people of color. This is Juneteenth Day as well as Father's Day, and a very important day for them. And Lord, we stand with them and celebrate this day, the day they found out that they were indeed free. And Lord, we have not done well in our interaction with our brothers and sisters. And would you teach us, as people of a kingdom who have been set free, what it's like to interact with people who have been harmed and oppressed in so many ways. So we celebrate this day along with them. And Lord, we pray for our country. We pray for those in leadership over us, as you have taught us to do through your word. We pray for our governor. We pray for the state legislature. We pray for those in leadership in our state and local governments. We also pray for our national leaders. We pray for President Biden, that you would keep him safe. We pray for all those in leadership in Congress and the Supreme Court. We are grateful, Lord, that we have a country, that we have the freedom to pray for those that we sometimes disagree with, but still, Lord, we're obedient to you to pray for those who lead us. And so we ask that you protect them and give them wisdom. And now may the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Christ, our rock and our redeemer. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
When we gather in this place, there is power, there is grace.
I see God's love on each face. When we gather in this place, make no mistake.
fount of every blessing, till my heart to sing thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise mine Ebenezer, hither by thine help I come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts
Adam lay with his wife Eve, and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, "With the help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Later, she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now, Abel kept flocks, and Cain worked the soil. In the course of time, Cain brought some of the fruits of the soil as an offering to the Lord. But Abel brought fat portions from some of the firstborn of his flock. The Lord looked with favor on Abel and his offering, but on Cain and his offering he did not look with favor. So Cain was very angry, and his face was downcast. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? Why is your face downcast? If you do what is right, will you not be accepted? But if you do not do what is right, sin is crouching at your door. It desires to have you, but you must master it." Now Cain said to his brother Abel, "Let's go out to the field." And while they were in the field, Cain attacked his brother Abel and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is your brother Abel?" "I don't know," he replied. "Am I my brother's keeper?" The Lord said, "What have you done? Listen, your brother's blood cries out to me from the ground. Now you are under a curse, and the ground now from the ground. Now you are under a curse and driven from the ground, which opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. When you work the ground, it will no longer yield its crops for you. You will be a restless wanderer on the earth." Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is more than I can bear. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me." But the Lord said to him, "Not so. If anyone kills Cain, he will suffer vengeance seven times over." Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who found him would kill him. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod, east of Eden. This is the Lord's word.
Thank you, Marilyn. Well, isn't that a happy story? East of Eden. Somebody wrote a good book about that, with that title. I can't remember who it was. Yeah, John Steinbeck. So, there's a lot in this story, and there are questions, if you've followed what Marilyn read a moment ago, that you have, like, who is Cain afraid of? Did you follow that? So we have Adam and Eve, they gave birth to Cain, and then Abel, and then Cain does this terrible thing, and now he's frightened that someone is going to kill him. Who is that? Brothers and sisters, Robin says, but we don't know. And you know what? Here's the thing. Anyone who says they know who it is lying to you. Because nobody knows, and this is one of the mysteries of this story, is that we are given, as someone said Wednesday night when we looked at this, parts of the story, but we don't know the whole story. This has troubled a lot of people. Like, who are these folks that Cain has to be protected from? And so anyway, anyone who tells you they know for sure who it is, there's probably lies about other stuff. So I'm not even going to go and answer some of this stuff. All right? I'm not saying you lie about that. It wasn't a reference to you, Robin. But you probably do lie about some stuff. I don't know. Well, I'm not going to go and answer all the questions. I do want to talk to you what I think is a very important part of this story. This is one of the saddest stories in all of God's Word. I mean, Adam and Eve are just fresh out of the garden, and they have these children, and they grow up, and suddenly there is the first example of fratricide. Brother killing brother. In 1991, some of you will remember this, 1991, two hikers are on a trail in the Italian Alps, and they discover the remains of an ancient corpse. Enough ice had melted away, and here's this corpse. And they did some scientific studies about it, and they determined that the corpse was 5,300 years old. It's the oldest intact corpse of any Homo sapien ever discovered. The remains of that are fascinating. Sometimes they've been called the Iceman. Some of you might have heard about this. And that dry mountain air and that hard Alp ice kept them preserved almost in a pristine way. When they studied it some more, we discovered that Iceman had some things in common with Abel. For instance, through the artifacts and some of the things he carried with him, we discovered that he probably was a shepherd, which is what Abel was. Interesting. The other thing that is similar to Abel is that he had been murdered, shot in the back with an arrow. Now, I want you to think about this. The oldest living, not living, the oldest remains of a Homo sapien that we have is not tucked away in a nice graveyard and in a very careful place and with a beautiful mark grave, but sprawled on the side of a mountain in a remote and face down with an arrow sticking out of his back. Murder and anger have been around a long time. The first actual manifestation of sin in human history is murder. Not just murder, a murder of a brother. This is frightening to us. If you listen carefully to this story, the story of Cain and Abel, you're going to hear echoes of an earlier story that we talked about a few weeks ago. When humanity turns their back on God and does not allow God to be at the center, at the core of their existence, when we turn our backs on God, our willingness to stay connected to brotherly love and community with one another starts to deteriorate and creation is ruptured. Our sin history has a way of repeating itself. So I want to invite you to look at this story with me. He says here in the very first part of the verses that Marilyn read to you a moment ago, "Now the man knew his wife Eve, and she conceived and bore Cain, saying, 'I have produced a man with the help of the Lord.'" It almost is written like a limerick. It's almost like a little chorus for a song. "I got me a man, I got me a man, thank God Almighty, I got me a man." But I find it fascinating that there is no mention of Adam anywhere in there. That sounds about right, doesn't it, guys? Then verse 2 says, "Next, she bore his brother Abel." So the first part of this, she's singing a song. "I got me a man, I got me a man." Second son, you got another guy. You got another one now. Abel is his name. She's no breaking out in song this time. They just had another one. Just like another pup in the litter, right? Families can be pretty strange when it comes to birth order. They really can. As a pastor, I want to tell you, when we have young children in the church and the brand new babies, the first child of a couple, sometimes those couples overreact maybe. Would that be a fair thing to say about what's happening with their kiddos? Sometimes that happens. It reminds me of this story about this family photo album. And you notice the relationship between the birth order and how many pictures there are of each child. So if you were to show the photo album, and the parents will tell you something like this: "Here's the picture of our first child, Jenny, when she was born. Here she is 1 minute old. Here's Jenny an hour old. Here's another book of Jenny on her second day." And then comes an album for their second child. "Here's Danny being born. Here's a picture of Danny on his second day. Here's Danny walking." And then another picture album comes along, their third child. "Here's a picture of Amy being born. Here's a picture of Amy's first day at school." And then the fourth child, if they have a fourth child, "Here's a picture of Bob being born." We need to get some more pictures of Bob. Yeah, that's about right. I mean, as the birth order goes down, things change. So here we have, sometime later, things begin to become unraveled between these boys. They're grown and they're trying to go to worship together. But the narrator, the writer of the book of Genesis, doesn't fill in a lot of details. Gives us details that I don't understand and doesn't fill in a lot of gaps. And so we're kind of left with trying to figure out what's going on here. So let me help to maybe fill in some of the gaps. When I did a study on this, I found out that the names of these two boys are very important. The name Cain in Hebrew is a play on the word that means gotten. She's gotten something special from the Lord. Someone who will perhaps care for her when Adam is no longer on the scene. This is her future. She's gotten something here. Cain also has a shade of meaning that indicates someone being a producer, someone who will create, someone who gets things done. So it's the idea, I've gotten something, and that something is going to get things done. And I think this is very important in light of what Abel's name means. Abel's name means in Hebrew, mist or vapor, barely there. In birth order, there's a lot of middle child and last child who feel like they have been forgotten. Abel is that one that's just barely there. He wants us to see that Adam and Eve have somebody, Cain, and they have a nobody, Abel. And so think about these two boys growing up. This is how Cain would have identified himself. I'm the firstborn. I'm the most important. I'm the one that mom sang a song about. I'm the one that is dad's right-hand man. And the foundation of his identity is built right here on his existence with his name. I'm somebody. I'm a go-getter. I'm a lot better off than my brother. My brother, who is the second born, is just going to have to kind of come in on my coattails. By the way, this is true in all of the cultures of the day. The firstborn had everything. The firstborn were the most important. And I want to do a little side thing here with you about this. One of the fascinating things about the scripture is the scripture tends to subvert conventional thinking about the firstborn being the most important. You see this throughout all the scripture. The Bible doesn't really say that the firstborn is not important, but it always subverts it. For instance, right here, whose offering is received by God? The secondborn. Over and over again in the scripture, the firstborn is not blessed. Esau, for example, Esau and Jacob, do you remember that story? Esau's the firstborn twin. But Jacob is the one that is really selected by God. Over and over again, this happens. So here's what's happening here. These names, they grow up with these names. I'm somebody, you're nobody. And if you don't think that played a part in the sibling rivalry that was about to kind of come into play here as they were growing up, then it's just true. I'm better than my brother. And then I want to look at the offerings that these brothers brought. We're told that Abel offered the very best portions of his very best sheep to God. The scripture says the fat portions. And we think, why the fat? In the culture in this was written in, the fat was an indicator of bounty and the very best parts. And if you're going to have steak this afternoon, like I'm going to have steak this afternoon, you know you want some fat in that steak. You want it to be well marbled because why? That's where the flavor is, right? And so here is Abel bringing the very best portions of the very best part of what he produced. Not Cain. Cain didn't do that. Scripture says Cain brought an offering. In the course of time, verse 3 says, Cain brought to the Lord an offering. An offering of the fruit of the ground. And Abel, for his part, brought of the firstlings of the flock and the fat portions. Now that may not seem like a big deal, but it's a big deal. The offerings are indicators. Hope you can hear this. The offerings that these boys brought are indicators of where God fit in their value system of life. In Abel's value system of life, God was central. God was at the very heart of it all. The writer of Hebrews says that the reason God received his offering was because he gave it through faith. It was very core to him. His whole world centered around worshiping God because he brought him the very best that he had. Not so Cain. Cain just, you know, gave an offering. Cain just kind of came to church. Maybe tipped God in the, I was going to say offering plate, but in the offering box. God was something he thought about on Sundays. Wasn't core to who he was. Wasn't integral to who he was. These offerings are hugely telling about the relationship that Cain had with God and the relationship that Abel had with God. Cain derived his identity based upon the weakness of his brother. He knows what his name means. He knows what his parents think of him and what his parents think of his little brother. And what starts to boil deep down in Cain is the truth that God liked what his little brother did more than he liked what he was able to produce. And so the eternal truth of this story is that when anyone builds their identity on anything other than the God of the universe, that identity will fail them and end up destroying them. If I've built my identity on my ability to perform or achieve or my beauty or my reputation, then when something comes along and threatens that area, I come unraveled before God. Cain looked at Abel, this nobody, throwing some meat on the altar, and then seeing that God liked what he did, this ate at Cain in ways that we sometimes think we can't imagine, but if we really stopped and listened to our heart, it would indicate to us what's going on. There is a character in Shakespeare's play Othello. His name is Iago. And Iago hates Othello. And he devises a way to murder him while blaming it on somebody else. And he says of this incredible rival that he has at the very beginning of the play, he talks about Othello this way: "He hath a daily beauty in his life that makes me ugly." He hath a daily beauty in his life that makes me ugly. Cain's offering is rejected by God, and he interprets that as somehow his brother is better than him at something. He can't have that. He's the go-getter. He's the firstborn. Now, I know this is a real issue. I know this. I have a brother that's a year younger than me. And when it came time for both of us, at age 6 for him and then about age 5 for me, let me tell you this. My little brother was saved and baptized before I was. And I'm telling you, that hurt me. It irritated me. Do you remember this? It bothered me. I'm the first. I should be the first one saved. I should be the first one baptized. I'm the firstborn. I can tell you, it bothered me a great deal. I remember being 7 years old and it troubling me. I know this is real stuff. This happens in our lives. It happens in our lives when our lives are not centered around Jesus. And the ugly comes out. Abel stops being a brother to Cain, and he starts being a threat. And I will tell you, that's true with my brother too. My brother stopped being my brother and started being my threat. And off and on in my relationship with my brother, who will be here in a month to teach you God's word, and he's a phenomenal Bible teacher, but off and on in our history, it has bothered me a great deal of the talent and the ability and the intelligence of my brother. I should have gotten that because I'm the firstborn, because I'm important. And the days in my life as a man when God was not at the center of my life, I promise you, my brother's success bothered me more than anyone else's success did. Can you hear me this morning? It happened and it showed up when I was all about me and not about Jesus. Now I want to pause here for a minute. Look at verse 6. The Lord said to Cain, "Why are you angry? And why has your countenance fallen? If you do well, will you not be accepted? And if you do not do well, sin is lurking at the door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it." This is a primordial picture of what God is doing in this first story, but what he does for each of us. There are a lot of young people who look at the way that the church has interacted, especially publicly in the last several years. And they will sometimes go to these places in the Old Testament and see, look at what a violent God and what the church is perpetrating on the world. And that's true. There are some places where you think, I don't understand why God's doing this. But then there are some places where you think, my goodness, God is showing so much grace. We have a picture in this passage of a change in how God interacts with Cain. I think it's beautiful. And Cain still turns his back on God. God is going out to Cain, not unlike the prodigal father went out to the older brother in Luke 15. Do you remember this? The father goes out to the older brother in Luke 15 and invites him to come in to the party because his younger brother has been celebrated. He's come home. God goes to Cain and says, what's going on? What's wrong with you? There are some things happening with you. And Cain doesn't want to go to God, but God wants to go to Cain. And God goes to Cain. This isn't this angry God throwing down thunderbolts from Sinai. This is a God who went looking for a boy who's upset. So God goes and looks for Cain. That sounds like Jesus to me. But Cain doesn't listen to God. So in the field in which perhaps these boys played, as little boys and brothers will do, they play together, and perhaps the same field in which they played, Cain cuts his brother down. Verse 6 says, Cain said to his brother Abel, let us go out into the field. And they were in the field, and Cain rose up against his brother and killed him. Then the Lord said to Cain, where is your brother Abel? And he said, I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper? And the Lord said, what have you done? Listen, your brother's blood is crying out to me from the ground. Cain cut his brother down. And he cannot make this murder go away. We've talked about this on Wednesday evening. This sounds an awful lot like an Edgar Allan Poe story, doesn't it? The telltale heart that still beats. And here it is. Cain can't get this murder to be over with. The blood of Cain's slain brother keeps crying out to God, and God hears it. I think the danger for we who have been in the Bible a lot over the years since these stories were told with Flannelgraph is to be saddened by it, but also to keep it at arm's length. I don't know about you, but for me, when I read the story, my knee-jerk reaction to say, this is terrible, but I would never do that. I would never do that. There's a zero chance that I'm going to kill anybody. I believe, though, there was a day when if you were to go to Cain and say, Cain, there's going to come a day when you're going to hate your brother so badly that you're going to kill him. He would have said, no way. That's not me. That's not who I am. I love my brother. I promise you, this was not in the script he had for his life. But it happened. There was a day when Cain said, I'm done with Abel. Because I think that the murder of Abel did not begin in the field. I think the murder of Abel began long before his offering was rejected. I think the murder began in his heart. And he kept looking at his brother. And long before he went to worship, and then for that walk in the field, he had something in his heart against his brother. So let me ask you a very poignant question. What is in your heart right now that if it continues on the trajectory that your heart wants it to, would lead you to a place that you cannot come back from? What is in your heart? What are you hiding or coddling or pretending is just not that big a deal? Or maybe what are you justifying and explaining away in your heart that you have a good reason for the feelings you have towards your father or a good feeling you have towards your son or your wife or a friend? It's easy for us to write these kinds of things off when we only live on our insides. I'm not being dishonest with this person that I work with. I just am kind of shrewd in business, so I don't share everything. I'm not being stingy with the money that God has blessed me with. I'm being frugal. I don't hate him, that's a strong word, but he needs to see that what he's done to me is not going to be tolerated, and the pain he's caused needs to be dealt with. And on and on, we kind of justify these feelings that we have in our heart that began in our mind and that will one day show up in our hands. That's how it works. We nurse darkness that lurks at our door, and we wind up acting on it in some fashion. But there's good news in this story. Karen got into it Wednesday night, had to stop her because she was going to get into my sermon. Verse 11, look at verse 11. God speaking to Cain, he says, "Now you are cursed from the ground, which has opened its mouth to receive your brother's blood from your hand. And when you till the ground, it will no longer yield to you its strength. You will be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth." In other words, you can no longer call the ground in which your brother's blood has flowed yours. It's no longer home to you. It's home to your brother now. Verse 13, Cain said to the Lord, "My punishment is greater than I can bear. Today you have driven me away from the soil, and I shall be hidden from your face, and I shall be a fugitive and a wanderer on the earth, and anyone who meets me may kill me." He doesn't want God, but he doesn't want to be away from God either. "I don't want you at the center of my life so that I give you the very best of my offering, but I don't want to be away from you." This is a classic place for a lot of church-going folks. "I don't want to just give up the faith, but I don't want to always be all the way in either." This is where Cain is. He doesn't want to live in the land of Nod, which literally means the land of wandering, because God isn't there, and the land is filled apparently with killers that we don't know where they came from. It's filled with people like him. It's filled with killers like Cain. And so Cain makes the same discovery that all of us make, that we need the same God we don't always want to be around. We need the same God that we don't always want to be close to. Because without God, we are fugitives and wanderers. We're not at home with ourselves. We're not at home with God. We spend all our lives in fight or flight, sometimes both at the same time. But mercifully, God does something for Cain. Look with me at verse 13, or 15 it is. "Then the Lord said to him, 'Not so. Whoever kills Cain will suffer a sevenfold vengeance.' And the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one who came upon him would kill him. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden." God gives a mark to protect the man who would not protect his brother. And by doing that, God cuts the loop of violence and revenge. And this is where I think we can see some hope. It's interesting that not a single word is ever uttered by Abel. We don't have an example of one word except his blood. Cain murders him, and Cain has plenty to say. He has lots of excuses. He has lots to say. But not one syllable from Abel. Abel speaks a different language. He speaks an eloquence that comes from his blood. "The voice of your brother's blood is crying to me from the ground," God says. So his blood has a voice. The blood cries out to God, and the blood is heard in heaven. There comes a time, though, the writer of Hebrews says this. I found this verse. I thought this was fascinating. to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. Do you see who speaks a better word than the blood of Abel? His name's Jesus. I love that. God hears Abel's cry from the ground. He hears Abel's blood cry from the ground, and he steps in to do something about it. And then God goes looking for Cain and takes care of Cain. In a miniature way, this is the whole story of Scripture. God hears the cries of the people that nobody else hears. Abel is a nobody. The people of God in Israel, in Egypt, are nobodies, but God hears their cries. And God hears the cries of people that no one else hears. And he steps in on behalf of the weak, and he pursues in dogged faithfulness people who are prone to fight or flight, people who are constantly in turmoil, people who don't give God any good reason to love, people just like me and people just like you. This is the story of all of Scripture. There's jealousy, there's envy, there's anger, there's death, murder, generation after bloody generation, until the day when God would come for a world full of Cains and full of Abels in the person of Jesus of Nazareth. And the New Testament writers take pains to tell us that Jesus is the very presence of the living God, but also Jesus is fully one of us, that Jesus is fully human, the most human being that ever lived. And at the cross, Jesus identifies with victims like Abel, who have been harmed and oppressed and beaten down, and he identifies with them because that's who he is. But he also identifies with people who resort to violence, and he rescues all of us, even the Cains of this world, because all of us have a little Cain. And all of us have a little Abel in us. So who do you identify with in this story? You know, I mentioned earlier that this is Juneteenth. African-American brothers and sisters in Christ will tell you they would definitely identify with Abel. Definitely. And some of us don't like all this politics and stuff. It's not politics to them. It's their history. It's the history of what people who are the firstborn, the people who had the power, the people who were somebodies, did to them. They're Abel. Who do you identify with? And there are people in this room that have been harmed by others, and nothing's ever been done about it. Perhaps you've been on the receiving end of somebody's anger or resentment or manipulation in a way that you still have scars. And you've been taken advantage of maybe by a parent or a coworker or a brother. Here's the good news. Even when it seems like nobody else sees your plight, God sees. God knows. God hears. This is hard for me to understand. Because maybe you were victimized by someone. But God decided to come into this world, dark world, and ultimately be a victim himself, so that you would be able to feel someone who knows what you've felt like, to be closer to you than your own breath. But the hard part is, if you've ever harmed someone, and we all have, through power or violence or manipulation or neglect, God came and put himself at the mercy of the forces of this world to take all the hate and the anger and the murderous intent that was in you on himself so that you wouldn't have to pay for that. He's given us a sign of grace. I have thought about that this week, and I don't know if this is accurate. I should probably ask someone who I should have read about it maybe, but you know what I think the sign of grace is? I think it could be the ordinances that we celebrate from time to time here. I think baptism and communion. When you are dipped into the beautiful watery grave and you come up out of that in newness of life, that's a mark. That's a mark of grace. When you feel that water on your body, that's a mark of grace. And every time you partake in communion and you feel the broken corners of that unleavened bread, and you taste the tang of that fruit on the vine on your tongue, that is a sign, that is a mark of grace that has been lavished upon you for eternity. You and I are marked people. You're a marked man and you're a marked woman. The mark is grace. And I think it's a beautiful story of how God deals with bad people and gives them an invitation to grace. That's really good news for a stinker like me. Thank you, Jesus, for the mercy that you have shown Cain and Joe and others in this room. Because we've got Cain and we've got Abel in here today. And sometimes we're in the same body. And you are asking us, why are you cast down? Why is your countenance low? Why are you hurting? What have you done? And the invitation, because of what Jesus did on the cross, is just to come. Come into the celebration of the Son that has come home. Come in and participate in the joy of the Lord. Come. I don't know, Lord, but when I read this story, I saw myself in this story. And I saw some others here too. And I know that you're a God of grace and a God of love. And you've called us to yourself to come home. And so, Lord, we come. As you have your heads bowed and your eyes closed just for a moment of reflection, could I ask you to just spend a moment in gratitude? Gratitude to Jesus. For what he did on the cross. For all of those who have felt oppressed and manipulated and beaten down by the darkness of this world at the hands of other brothers and sisters. Would you just say thank you? And if you identify with Cain and Joe, wouldn't you just say thank you for taking the punishment that belonged to you? Would you just say thank you? Let's stand together, please. Thank you for listening today. Please remember to sign up for Wednesday night so I know how much taco salad to make. Lynette will be out there with a sign-up sheet and blocking all the exits so that you can't leave without signing up. Let's say the prayer that we have been praying for a long time here. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. leave here today, go home, call your dad. Okay? May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you shalom. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessings, friends.